teaching of Sixth Patriot.
Okay.
He talked about not seeing mistakes of other people. Like, I find and concentrated only on the faults of yourself.
Self.
Yes. Yeah. I found it nearly impossible. Can you, can you please talk about it?
Yes, it's completely impossible.
Sorry, yes, repeat the question.
Sure. So he asked about, there is an encounter between the sixth patriarch and a monk. The monk's name was Shen Shu. And the monk asked the sixth patriarch, do you see or do you not see? Then the sixth patriarch said, I both see and I don't see, which was kind of, nobody understood what that meant. And then they asked him, what does that mean? And he said, well, when I look, I don't see the faults of others. But when I look inside myself, I see my faults. So from that comes actually our in our school, we're always saying, don't check anything, right? You've heard that. So human beings are always checking. So they're always checking, did I win or did I lose? Is this good or is this bad? Do I like it or do I not like it? Is it life or death? You know, so originally this checking comes from your body. So every human being has a body. So because you have a body, first of all, you want food, right? That's natural. And you want sex, right? Everybody has some kind of sexual feeling. And it comes in all different kinds of, different styles, right? So there's a man's style, a woman's style. You know, there's everything you can imagine. Everything you can think of goes into that desire. And it comes originally from your body. Then you also want to sleep, right? That's natural. When you get tired, you want to sleep. Then you also want money, right? That's the fourth one. Well, the reason you want money is because you want a good situation, right? There's no better way to have that than to have a lot of money. And then the fifth one is fame. So fame means praise and blame. Like everybody wants to be liked. So if I say, I'm going to say to him, but he shouldn't. You shouldn't attach to what I'm saying. You're stupid, right? Then inside he has a feeling, right? Wait a minute. I'm not stupid. Or he might say, well, he's a little bit right, I'm afraid. I'm stupid. Right? So anytime anybody says something good to you, you react. Like, uh-huh. That's nice. And if they say something bad, you think, then you have a bad feeling. Even if they're right, you have a bad feeling. And if they say something good to you, even if they're wrong, you still have a good feeling. So that also comes from our body, because human beings are designed to cooperate to get what they want. Like Confucianism, you know about Confucianism, right? Confucianism is all designed about, well, how can we cooperate to get what we want? So every human being operates that way. Because just think, if you weren't cooperating with other human beings, what would you have? Nothing. Right? Like, where does your food come? Well, it comes from Guangdong province somewhere. So you have to cooperate, right, to get what you want. But human beings don't like to cooperate because they're also checking the people that they cooperate with, and that's where praise and blame comes from. So human beings are always very attached to praise and blame. Right? So everybody has that. But we say, don't do that. And the Buddha also said, don't do that. But everybody does it. So that's a problem. Actually, it's a mistake. So seemingly, these very basic things that we are is a mistake. Of course, that's why the Buddha, that's why I said, if you really listen to what the Buddha said, you're not going to like it, because he's talking about these very basic mistakes people make. Surrounding sex, food, sleep, fame, and money. Very basic things, you know, like, that's where we live. Then he says, the world is upside down, meaning all those things are actually causing suffering. So, what to do about them? What to do about it? So, he just taught, you don't take them away, right? You can't stop eating, you probably aren't going to stop having sex, and you need some money to live, and you got to sleep, right? So his message was, don't attach to them. So when we practice, we're just practicing to let go, not to get rid of. So one thing we're always doing is checking. So this is what this thing about with the sixth patriarch says. The sixth patriarch says, when I see, I don't see other people's mistakes. That means don't check. Don't check up on other people. But it doesn't mean like it doesn't appear in your mind. It means don't attach to it. So when I was younger, I used to be a teacher. I always talk about this because it's a really easy example to understand. So if you're a teacher, you're at the head of the classroom, and then there's students. So your job is to teach them. And you have to teach the ones that you like and the ones you don't like. So any classroom will have people in it you don't like, guaranteed. It'll also have people in it that you do like, guaranteed. But your job is the same. Whether you like them or don't like them, your job is to teach them. So that's just the teacher's job. And the correct teacher's job is not to check the students, except for one thing, how they did in the class, right? So you have to give them a grade. You know? So if you went to school, you got grades. That's actually correct, given that situation. But if they gave you a grade because they liked you, then that's not so good. And if they gave you a bad grade because they didn't like you but you did well in the class, then that also is not so good. So the correct thing to do in that situation is to teach irrespective of whether you like the student or don't like the student. So that's not checking. Right? So when the sixth patriarch says, I only see my own mistakes, I don't see other people's mistakes, that's because he's not checking the outside world. But then he says, but I do see my own mistakes. So that also is a human being's job, to have the wisdom to see what they are actually doing moment to moment to moment in their life. So that also has to be done in a way where you're not attached to it. Because if you're always checking yourself, you'll drive yourself crazy. Right. Human beings do it all the time. That's why psychologists make so much money. Human beings are always checking themselves. And it drives you literally nuts. So somehow you have to be able to let go of that. But also you have to perceive what you're doing and have some wisdom about what you're doing. So in English we have this very interesting saying. This person is hitting their hand with a hammer. Now that hurts. Right? So if somebody walks by somebody that's doing that, then they'll say, well, the person that's hitting their hand looks up at the other person and says, you know, my hand really hurts. And they're hitting their hand with a hammer. Then the person walking by looks down at that person and says, stop hitting your hand with the hammer. And if you do that, your hand is going to feel better. Okay? So in there is, I mean, this is really stupid. But in there is some wisdom, you know, if you hit your hand with a hammer, your hand is going to hurt. So there's some wisdom there. So it's the same. I see my mistakes, but I'm not attached to that. I also see he sees other people's mistakes too, but he doesn't attach to them. That's what do not check means, don't attach to. It doesn't mean like it's not going to happen, because it is going to happen. And even inside of it, it has wisdom. So there's no absolute rules about anything, actually. But each situation, inside each situation, there's wisdom. So, boom, boom. Oh, don't do that. Oh, yeah, great. Good idea. But usually people are doing all kinds of things to themselves. You know, they're drinking. And you say to a person that's drinking, don't drink. Stop drinking. You, stop drinking. Right? Then you think,
oh, yeah, right.
Start exercising. Then you think, oh yeah, that's a really good idea. Tomorrow I'm going to do that. In the West, we're always going to do it tomorrow. I don't know. So that's what that means. You know, I see and I don't see. So the I see part is actually a kind of wisdom. And the I don't see is also a kind of wisdom. And it's the wisdom of not being attached. So there's all kinds of different teaching and teaching styles and things that are said, you know. But you don't want to attach to any of them. You want to see what their behind meaning is. Because usually the meaning is not on the surface. So there's like this beating that Lin Chi got. The meaning of the hitting was actually, you know, it's just this. That was the meaning. So, did you get it? That's the meaning. Really, very interesting. So there's all kinds of teaching like that. You have to see what the behind meaning is. Usually the behind meaning is really stupid. So there's nobody in this room that hasn't seen a star, right? Everybody seen a star? That's it. That's why we always say it's not special. Zen is not special. You just think it's special. Also, we use special as a technique. And boy, will you be surprised. It's not special. Same with that style of teaching. So all of those are just different techniques. That's all. They all point at the same thing. Any other questions? Any kind of questions?
Yes. Some people say towards the end of the Dharma, so not as many people can.
Right.
Yeah, and then sometimes people suggest you do a lot of prostration, and then so your back karma will
go away.
Be reduced. But how? Maybe we can establish our confidence through that. I just want your comment on that, because I feel we need more confidence in ourselves, and any way we can do it.
Right. So lack of confidence comes from your thinking. Also, your confidence comes from your thinking. So, telling somebody like you should do a lot of bowing, that's actually a technique to take away your thinking, to detach you from your thinking. So, when you bow, you should just bow. But we might say, when you bow, you're taking away your karma. Or we might say, when you bow, you're repenting, right? Or we might say, well, you, if you bow, you'll build up your confidence about the true meaning of practice, right? We'll say that, right? But the behind meaning is not anything special. So did you ever bow?
Yeah.
So in Zen we say, when you bow, just bow. So just bow is true repentance. Just bow is just do it, which is true confidence. So true confidence comes from just doing something. So now you just blinked your eyes, right? That's it. So nobody says, well, you have to have a lot of confidence to blink your eyes. But you do it just naturally. But when you think about it, like everybody's blinking all the time, because particularly with a lot of pollution coming into town, you have to blink a lot. So when you do it naturally, then you become one with it. So by doing a repetitious thing like bowing, after a while you'll let go of your thinking and you'll just do it. It happens all the time when you're bowing. So Zen, we usually have you do something very repetitious so that you can let go of your thinking. So chanting, we always do the same chanting every day. How boring. And bowing, we do the same bowing every day. How boring. And sitting, we do, that's really boring. And we eat this special kind of style, which is really kind of interesting for about 5 minutes. And it's really boring. So all of those things are just techniques so you can let go of your thinking, so you just do what you do. Right? So actually that's true repentance. So in the precept ceremony it says, if you extinguish your mind, that's true repentance. Right? So when you bow, yeah, you're bowing. While you're bowing, you're hardly ever doing anything bad to anybody else, right? You know, you're not robbing a bank. You're not getting drunk, and you're not, you're just bowing. So that is it. One very interesting thing about the way human beings think is they think that they're going to do something and then they're going to get a result. Right? Everybody thinks that way. If I do something, I'll do this, and then down the road here it'll have a result. Well, in Buddhism, something completely different is going on. The result is what you're doing. There's no result. Bowing is confidence. So to become one. There's no hope. Hope is about something that's going to happen in the future, right? I'm going to get something. That's something in the future. But those things don't exist. So how can you repent? You're repenting about something that happened in the past, which doesn't exist, to achieve some kind of a state in the future where you're saved, doesn't exist. So many times religion talks about salvation, right? You're like, you're going to be saved. And when does salvation happen? So Buddhism is really interesting because there's no salvation in Buddhism. It's not a salvation religion. You know, Christianity is always talking about salvation. Judaism doesn't have salvation. Taoism doesn't have salvation. Confucianism doesn't have salvation. And Buddhism also doesn't save you from anything. But you are already saved. You know, that's what the Buddha teaches. It's just that you don't know it. So the first thing the Buddha said after his enlightenment was, how wonderful, everything already has it. Everything already has Buddha nature. But human beings don't know that. And because they don't know it, they suffer. So you don't know what you are. So we have you bow so that you find out what you really are. You know what you are when you're bowing? Right. That's all you are. But you can think all of the kinds of things, you know. But you're this. You just think you're something else. That's why I beat him with a stick. Because how else will you take away that? Then you become one. And that, you know, this ability to think is not good and not bad. You just don't want to let it control you, that's all. Yeah, so that's building your confidence. You know, confidence is also a kind of thinking. It's not good or bad either. But, wake up just now. That's it. Okay? That's why we tell people to do these stupid things. Because the result is stupid. Very interesting. That's why Zen's so hard to teach. Because there's nothing to teach. What could be more difficult than teaching somebody something that doesn't exist? Any other questions? Well, that's enough talking. What do we do now? It's 4:30. Oh, one other thing I wanted to say just briefly is I'd like to thank the Subong Zen Monastery and its staff and the staff here at Gaksu for making this happen. And all of you also make that happen. So one very important thing is, if you want to help people, is how are you going to help them? So one way to help them is to provide them with good teaching and a place to practice. So everybody here makes that happen. So by coming and practicing with other people, whether it's for 5 minutes or 30 years, it doesn't make any difference. That is very, very helpful. So I want to thank the people that run the Subong Zen Monastery and all of you and everybody that makes this place go. It's incredible. Because it points to this one very simple thing that helps the whole world. So, thank you all.